My name is Jörg Haas. I am heading the Department of International Politics at the Heinrich-Böll Foundation. And it's an extreme pleasure to welcome all of you in this important debate on carbon pricing. We have among us three of the most interesting exponents of a really important debate that we really need to get right. What is the role of carbon pricing in climate politics? What are the prospects? And before I hand over to our moderator, who will present the panelists, let me just indicate to you that this is a discussion which will be held in English, but which is simultaneously translated into German. So if you want to hear German, just click on the bottom right on a button with a globe. Wenn Sie Deutsch hören möchten, klicken Sie rechts unten auf den Dolmetschen-Knopf in Zoom und dann hören Sie die deutsche Übersetzung oder können Sie dann das auswählen. So, it's an extreme pleasure to welcome Ottmar Edenhofer, David Victor and Danny Cullenward. I don't say much more than I'm just absolutely pleased. Several of my heroes in the international climate debates are this evening with us, and I'm really looking forward to this debate. I'm handing over to Petra Pinsler, a very prominent journalist from Die Zeit, who is also covering climate issues since many, many years, and also a very good expert on this issue. So, Petra, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Jörg, and hi to everybody. I'm really looking forward to the debate that we will be having in a moment, because as Jörg actually said, we do have three of the most prominent climate economists worldwide in this debate, but they're not just prominent, they're on two very opposite sides. And I think it will be quite easy to get them to debate, because two of them are rather critical when it comes to CO2 price, and one is defending it. The two that are very critical, the first one of them is Danny Cullenward. He's a forensic climate economist. I didn't ask him what forensic means. I know what climate economists are. Forensic, he still has to explain to me. He's an economist and a lawyer, and he works for Carbon Plan and the Stanford Law School. And he wrote a book together with David Victor, who is an economist and professor at the University in San Diego. And they are actually advocating or arguing that the CO2 price has some downsides, but I will not go into it because they will do it in just a minute. After I have presented to you Ottmar Edenhofer, who is probably well known to all of you. He's heading the Potsdamer Institute for Climate Impact Research, the PIC here in Germany. And he is rather one of the godfathers of the CO2 price. So let me, before I hand over to Danny Cullenward and David Victor, the rules of the game. They both will have, both parties will have about 10 minutes to explain their points. We think this is important in this kind of debate, that they have the time to really explain this rather difficult issue and their opinion on this rather difficult issue. And after that, I will debate with them, and you will already have the possibility to communicate with others in the chat. You will have the possibility, what you can do right away, to write in some questions. I will try to put them and use them when I moderate the Q&A. And that's about it. So I am looking forward to the first to David and to Victor. I know what they're writing, but I'm really keen to listen to you and to hear you arguing their point of view.
Excellent. Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Petra. Thank you, Jörg. Thank you to the Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung for hosting this. I mean, this is, I think, one of the most important debates, because we're now looking at how do we actually make big reductions in emissions. And that discussion, frankly, is overdue, but we're having it. And at the center of this is the question of what's the right role for markets? What's the right role for the state? Danny and I have a book out, Making Climate Policy Work. It's been out for a year or so. It's not a pro-market or anti-market book. It's an empirical book. It takes centrally and seriously the beautiful logic of using market forces to try and make reductions in emissions. Then it looks at how well have we performed around the world? How have these market systems performed around the world? And with the one partial exception of the European Union emissions trading approach, with that one partial exception, the record is actually not that great. And in particular, we are very critical of cap and trade systems because the cap and trade systems in effect trade the residual of emissions that are left over after regulatory instruments have done their work. And so cap and trade systems almost create an illusion. We call it a Potemkin market. The illusion that the market system is actually doing the work, when you look behind the curtain, what you see is after market after market after market around the world, where these things have been put into place in China and California and the Northeastern United States, Quebec, on and on and on, what you see is that the market instrument's not actually doing most of the work. It's industrial policy, it's regulatory policy, and so on. One of the things we do in the book, it's hard to summarize a book, a big book, well, it's not a big book, but a pretty complex book in 10 minutes, as Danny and I are going to do. But one of the things we do in the book is we look at some of the places where our theory expected something to happen and then the opposite happened. So for example, one of the early expectations was that these market-based systems would create a global price or increasing the international price on carbon. And then we have international trading of emission credits or maybe a global carbon tax. And then that would create a better global solution to allocate capital and effort in the best places around the world. What we've seen in reality is the opposite. There's almost no international trading. In fact, the lowest quality emission credits that are trading across borders are the credits, the offsets that are trading across borders. And that's because when you create a cap and trade system, you're in effect creating a new kind of money. And so the quality of your policy instrument is only as good as the quality of the underlying institutions. And that explains why Europe has been pretty successful in this, and practically no other place has been pretty successful. And why jurisdictions, when they start getting really serious about their systems, are reluctant to link together lots of disparate different cap and trade systems, because in effect you get Gresham's law, you get the bad money driving the good money out of circulation. One of the other expectations early on in the theory around using market instruments was that we needed a market system, a cap and trade system, for example, that had the broadest scope possible, all different sectors included. That way the economy could figure out the lowest cost way, the best sectors to allocate effort. What you see instead is almost the opposite, that one of the ironies in these cap and trade systems is that as you add more sectors, the politics become different and more difficult. And that's because the politics and the technological opportunities vary in every sector. What's going on in steel is different from what's going on in automobiles, different yet again from what's going on in electricity. And so all of those different sectors have different political arrangements. And one of the things we've observed in many markets is that when you link transportation, you particularly make the politics very, very difficult for the other sectors to get a high price on carbon. Because in so many countries, look at the Yellow Vest movement in France, look at the blowback in the United States against high emission prices on transportation fuels. People know what transportation fuels in particular cost. And so the politics of raising the prices on transportation fuels are different and harder than the politics of raising prices on electricity or a variety of other areas. And so ironically, by linking all these different sectors together and following the economic logic, you actually make the politics harder. And this is what we're trying to grapple with in the book centrally, is how do you put together and hold together a set of policy instruments that actually make progress. I'm going to just say a couple more words and then hand it over to Danny. One of the things we do in the book is this book is not designed to say we shouldn't use markets. Instead, it's designed to say we should use markets in the places that are amenable to market instruments. In particular, we think carbon tax systems perform much better than cap and trade systems, because the marginal price in a carbon tax system is always there, even when there's regulation in place. And so we advocate a number of reforms, including frankly the reforms that we've been seeing in the European trading scheme that make it in effect more tax-like. We also think that for the sectors of the economy where emission reductions are very difficult to achieve, that it's industrial policy and regulation that's really going to push the technological frontier, not market instruments like carbon taxes. There are some sectors, in particular electric power, which are more amenable to these instruments, in part because the technologies are more mature. And so you're trying to use the market and a marginal price incentive to encourage firms to identify the lowest cost options and then to optimize around that. And that works when the technologies are more mature. Doesn't work so well when the goal is to push the technological frontier, where you need a huge carbon price. And it's frankly much easier politically and practically to do that directly with industrial policy. I'm going to give the floor over to Danny, who's going to say a few more words about our larger argument, but before we look forward to the comments from Ottmar and the debate.
Thank you, David, and thank you to the host for the chance to be here and to speak about these issues. I want to pick up on three issues that take some of the core arguments from our book. Exactly as David outlined, our book attempts to develop a logic for thinking through the political opportunities and challenges of when markets can work and when maybe they don't make as much sense. And I want to apply some of those basic insights to three issues today. One, what's going on in the European Union, where we as Americans are watching with keen interest for what we see the most successful program in the world doing and some of the challenges it's facing right now. I'm going to also touch on briefly the experience in California, where David and I both live and has arguably the most comprehensive cap and trade program, although not nearly as large as the European market. And I also want to touch on the role of carbon offsets and the voluntary carbon market, which is a topic we spent a little bit of time on in the book, but I think has some direct implications as we see lots of voluntary activity these days. So to begin with, let me talk about the European Union experience. I think what's so striking about the global experience with markets is that basically no markets have succeeded in developing a carbon price signal that is significant enough to start to drive emission reductions and significantly change the investment trajectory and technological frontiers in the sectors we know need to change. The one major exception to that is the European Union's program. And we think there's a number of factors that explain this, including the consistent support that the European public and policymakers have expressed for climate policy. One of the other key things that had to happen in Europe was to move away from low quality offsets and to design the system to have a central banking-like function where policymakers can add or subtract allowances to the market supply and essentially help dictate where the prices are going to go in response to policy opportunities and political challenges. This has worked relatively well. And I think, again, we see this as an area of success that we try to highlight in the book as an example of how some of the smart strategies can be deployed. One of the challenges that's coming up, where again, we are outsiders watching and doing our best to listen, is in an environment where we have essentially global energy market crises happening in multiple countries at the same time, largely as a result of the war. The challenge of trying to hold together a complicated system when other policy issues are becoming very, very prominent and having direct impacts on energy prices, which has political consequences and which has competitiveness consequences, those are significant challenges. And we're watching and seeing what we hope is some dynamic capacity to respond to those challenges, where again, the policy levers in this program can hopefully respond and prioritize and deprioritize opportunities to reduce emissions as the politics warrant and as is necessary to keep together a coalition that's strongly supportive of climate policy over time. One of the big challenges, of course, is that very few countries have a price on carbon that is at all comparable to the European price. And so the trade effects are quite significant. I'm reading in the news as the European Parliament is debating concepts like a carbon border adjustment, which, you know, potentially help address these issues, but there's a lot of work to be done. And there are very few governments that are even close to the capacity and expertise that Europe has right now in order to run these kinds of programs and policies. So very interested to talk more about what that means. But the fact that there is a price that applies to the power sector and across the industrial sector creates challenges because there's essentially a single level of effort that's applied to all of these different sectors that are facing different concerns around energy price impacts from a political and a competitiveness perspective. Again, we see signs of successful management, but it's not simple. Briefly on the California experience, I can touch more on this if we want to get into it in the conversation. California's program also includes transportation fuels. And because visibly increasing transportation fuels is one of the most difficult things you can ask a policymaker to do, our political system in California has largely tried to look the other way on the carbon market. We have assigned it the role to do all of our climate policy work in California, but we are not actually following through with the design that's capable of doing that, because the number one thing an elected official is afraid of in California is saying, "I'm raising the price of gasoline." And this emphasizes, although that would in theory be an economically efficient way to proceed, that it's very, very difficult politically to get that done. And if you tie in transportation fuel politics, it makes it hard to decarbonize other sectors using market-based signals. The last thing I want to mention, Petra mentioned that I call myself a forensic climate economist. There are lots of crimes being committed against the atmosphere. Many of them are being done through low-quality carbon offsets, where essentially unregulated systems have been designed to create the appearance of trading credits that make a difference. This is becoming an almost impossible to manage problem with no governance. And we are seeing a lot of activity pick up as private offset credits, which are generally very, very low quality, are being held forward as equivalent to the success and experience of, say, the European Union's cap and trade program. Everybody is selling a ton, but some tons are high quality, like the European allowances, and some tons are very, very low quality. Markets do a very poor job of telling the difference between the two. And the political economy lessons from our book help explain why those two systems end up in very different places. So again, this is not an argument against using markets. It's an argument about using political economy tools to figure out when they work and what to do to make them work better when you can. So I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you so much. And thank you for sticking to the timetable. I think we need another session to talk about the forensic part of the issue, which unfortunately is not our topic today, but I think this is really something interesting. Right now, I want Ottmar Edenhofer to respond right away to what we just heard.
Yeah, thanks a lot. It's an enormous pleasure to discuss this issue with Danny and David. And I'm very happy that we have now the opportunity to discuss this important issue. So carbon pricing, I would say many people would argue, okay, it might be a good policy. Climate economists for a very long time have argued that carbon pricing might be the first best option. But in the end, political economists and political scientists all the time argued it might be good policy, but it might be bad politics because it is very hard to have a winning coalition for such a thing. So in that sense, many economists are not very successful to communicate this because they do not take into account significantly or sufficiently enough the political environment. And in that sense, this book is a very interesting one and a very stimulating one. So the book admits that carbon pricing might be theoretically desirable, but hard to implement. And in addition to that, they argued that advocates of market-based instruments have overplayed what market-based policy instruments in reality can deliver. And therefore, policymakers should focus on pragmatic, politically feasible approaches for reducing emissions. And the authors highlights here that regulatory and other industrial policy instruments do most of the heavy lifting. So the two authors are not against the market instruments, but they want to find out what is the appropriate scope of the market instrument. So this is, from my point of view, what they want to do. And I agree with them. So when Daniel is arguing he's a forensic climate economist, I would say I'm a clinical climate economist because I want to understand under what specific conditions policy instruments can work. What I will do in my overview is I would review a little bit the empirical spread of carbon pricing, and then I would provide some additional arguments regarding the political feasibility. So I would argue that what's missing, so let me start with that, what's missing is a concise and a comprehensive meta study about the effects of carbon pricing. So we are carrying out such a study. Here, I can only highlight a few examples. So that carbon pricing is effective in the UK, a carbon price has led to a substantial emission reduction in the electricity sector. And then he has admitted this, that the electricity sector might be a place where market instruments, even according to the two authors, might work. I would say the difference is increasing in this empirical study after 2013. So we have seen a significant emission reduction because UK has introduced a carbon tax, a carbon price support in addition to the EU ETS. I believe that, or I assume that this will not cause too much difference because in the power sector, most people would agree carbon prices and cap and trade system, at least in the European context, has worked. It's a little bit more tricky to think about the transport sector because the transport sector, it is a sector which basically the price elasticity might be much lower than in the electricity sector. And then the question is what policy packages work. And what we have done here is, it's not published yet, but it's under review, that we have applied a machine learning method. And what we did is we want to find out what are the causal emission breaks over 25 years in the EU. And it turns out that only 10 significant policy-induced emission breaks in seven countries can be identified with this machine learning. And so this is just one example, which I have shown in Denmark. And it is obvious what the authors are also admitting is that it's not just only carbon pricing schemes, so there are a lot of regulatory measures. But what we have identified is that successful policy intervention have led to a sharp reduction of emissions in the transport sector. It has a large reduction potential, but all of these packages have one important component. These are carbon pricing for fuel, carbon prices, fuel taxes, or road use taxes with green vehicle incentives. I'm not saying the carbon price has done the only work here, but it is also the case that the carbon prices are essential for significant emission reduction, even in the transport sector. So we are just carrying out now a study where we try to understand what is the ban the new registration of internal combustion engines in Germany for 2030. This is a heavily debated issue in the European Parliament, but also in Germany. And it turns out that, to make a long story short, for a ban to have a meaningful impact on emissions, it has to be supplemented with a significant carbon price, because otherwise emissions cannot be reduced. And this is quite obvious why this is the case, because you can only, with a ban, you only ban the new combustion engines, but you have to deal with the old car fleet. And to increase the turnover, to reduce the and to increase the emissions of the driving, you need a CO2 price. And this is quite important. I'm not saying again that bans are inherently bad, but if you want to have emission reduction, it has to be complemented by some kind of carbon pricing schemes. Of course, the projected evolution of the carbon prices, so this is the most recent study. So this looks at least not so bad that we can observe some increase in carbon price, and also the scope is increasing. Admittedly, the scope is a little bit above 23% of the global coverage, and the coverage, given the climate policy goals we have, is lousy, but still it's interesting, it's increasing. Now, let me come to another aspect, and this is widely ignored by many economists, and these are the distributional consequences of these policy instruments. The distributional consequences are for an understanding of the politics absolutely crucial. And I'm not arguing here that we should go for a carbon price because it is the most efficient way. I think the carbon price has also some advantages if you think about the distributional effects. What we have done here is we have figured out what are the average burden on households for standards and for CO2 pricing with a kind of a recycling. And it turns out that poorer households drive smaller cars, and measured against their income, the costs of the standards hit them harder. The richest quintile has an income that it is about 3.5 times higher than of the poorest quintile, whilst using just under 1% more gasoline per kilometer. Poorer households travel less, far less distance, and thus benefiting much less from increased energy efficiency of the cars. So with an uncompensated CO2 price, standards are roughly at the same order of magnitude from the distributional point of view, but the CO2 prices allows you to generate revenues which then can be used for a compensation, in particular of the poor income households, and equal per capita recycling. And this is what this graph shows from one of our most recent studies here, that the red line, this is the uncompensated carbon price. And it is obvious that an uncompensated carbon price has strong regressive effects, which might induce yellow vests and all sorts of a threat to social cohesion. But if it is complemented with equal per capita recycling, you can create a benefit for the 20% of the poorest households. And in the debate, I would like to highlight a little bit on the current gasoline crisis, where we basically can apply the same instrument. Now, let me come to my last point. There is a conventional wisdom in the debate. Many people argue, okay, we had traditional climate policy, and the traditional climate policy was quite okay, in particular in the power sector. And we have been able to implement carbon markets, at least in Europe. But when it comes to the high cost options, where we have to decarbonize the industry sector, and we have to decarbonize the transport sector, carbon prices are too high in the end to drive the decarbonization pathway. And therefore people say, okay, carbon pricing did a job, probably not the most important one, it did a job in the past, but for the future, we need a completely different instrument. And to a certain extent, I agree, because nobody believes that immediately we can have a carbon price around 300 euros per ton CO2. Why 300? This is the order of magnitude which would be needed for producing hydrogen, come up with synthetic fuels and negative emissions. But again, what I would like to highlight here is that when we enter the area of the high carbon prices, in particular, when we enter technological changes, hydrogen sector, synthetic fuels, negative emissions. So sooner or later, we need high carbon prices. Why? We need high carbon prices because if the carbon prices are not high, we wouldn't use, for example, atmospheric CO2 to produce synthetic fuels. In that sense, I would say, as an immediate step, of course, industrial policy and subsidies are needed, but what is needed in the future is a phase-in of carbon prices. So this is my argument, and I can summarize this here in the following way. So in the past, we have seen a way where the political costs of standards were much lower than of the carbon prices. But in the future, when we basically want to achieve the ambitious goals, so then carbon prices in the end cause much lower costs. And therefore, I think in the future, command and control instruments have lower costs for low mitigation scenarios. I admit with that. But when we want to be more ambitious, carbon pricing in the future will become more important. So my disagreement with the authors is not so much about their factual statements. It is about the design of the future climate policy, because I think in the past, indeed, we had regulatory measures, we had bans, and we had subsidies. And to a certain extent, they have basically shown the success. But in the future, when it comes to the decarbonization, we need something different. So my last statement is technology standards, subsidies, mandates, and bans, they are just fine. And there are many reasons, even from an economic point of view, to use this technology standard and subsidies. But my argument is, when not complemented by prices, so this will not lead to this decarbonization pathways, which are needed to basically to achieve ambitious climate goals. So a dismal scientist's perspective on the political case against carbon pricing. I understand the salience argument. Prices increase the salience of the cost of climate policy. Fine. But my response would be, this holds only for the low level of ambition. Little empirical testing as voters respond to other instruments like bans. The first empirical studies show voters also respond to the high costs of technology standards. Attribution, subsidies, bans, and standards can be clearly attributed to politicians and parties. This is the reason why policymakers like them. This, my response would be, okay, this assumes a great deal of sophistication and attention on the part of the voters. In the end, attribution is nothing which is given by nature. It can be communicated. Volatility of prices in unregulated market, which is very much related also to the offset market, I agree. My response would be a price corridor. The last thing is really the hard thing. And here, I think this is worthwhile for a discussion. And is the commitment problem. Given the dynamics of electoral policy, it is rarely credible for politicians to commit to a price trajectory consistent with the climate ambition. And indeed, I think this is hard to resolve. And the reason why we have been more successful in Europe with these pricing schemes might be the fact that we have at the EU level, and the EU level can be used as a commitment device. Okay, carbon pricing, good policy, and not so dismal politics. To summarize, given ambitious climate targets, carbon pricing will become increasingly important. Without carbon pricing, the other policy instruments are either ineffective or have negative distributional consequences. Other instruments have lower salience in the short run, but higher mitigation costs than market instrument in the long run. And policymakers' lack of commitment might make subsidies for investments, bans, and standards tempting, but increasing costs reduce the feasibility of this route. The central question is, what kind of self-enforcing institutions can increase the commitment capacity of climate policymakers? And this is something which is, from my point of view, at the core of the debate. People, and from my point of view, this is the main argument of the book, it is a lack of commitment which basically hinders us to go for that. But I think we have to work with that. And this is something which needs a little bit more debate, and we might find a better balance between commitment and flexibility. Thanks a lot.
All right. A lot of food for thought, and I think a lot of food for debate. Let me tell the audience, you can, there's no problem if you want to send in your questions in German. I will be able to translate them. Dare to ask simple questions. This is also my job. I think my job is also to translate economists. And the first question with which I will try to translate the debate a bit into the real political area where I'm at every day, and where I have to deal with is, Ottmar, you actually argued a lot in favor of the CO2 price. At the same time, you admitted that only, I think, 23% of the CO2 emissions are covered by pricing. And your last point also was that you have not yet found this kind of institution that make politicians to go for higher CO2 prices. So to ask you the question very, very simple, even you who believe that this is the most brilliant kind of instrument that economists have, how do you argue with politicians that still tell you, look, we can't really go for real high CO2 prices? I mean, how do you translate your brilliant instrument?
I feel very misunderstood if you portray me as somebody who says, this is something which is so brilliant and it is so efficient, it is so wonderful. How can the dirty word ignore this? This is not my argument. My argument is technology standards, subsidies, and bans will not lead to the emission reduction we need for ambitious climate policy. At least it has to be complemented with ambitious carbon pricing. So this is my argument. It's not about efficiency, it's about effectiveness. And what I'm saying is also uncompensated carbon prices are quite regressive. This is not good. You have to do a recycling scheme. And the commitment problem is an interesting one. And probably you know that last week in the European Parliament, there was basically a rejection of the second EU ETS. Let's see what will happen in the next 2 weeks. My argument is not, it is so efficient, it is so brilliant, it is so nice, and it is so neat. What I'm saying is, even there are many good arguments why we should go in some cases for subsidies. And the last thing, for example, financing pilot projects for direct air capture, financing some projects for synthetic fuels. That's a lot of R&D investments. That's fine and that's important. But when this is not complemented by this, then it will not lead to this effective emission reduction. And you ask me, so what is the response for the politicians? I would say the politicians are at least, and this might be not a surprise, but not consistent. They say, okay, carbon neutrality by 2050, why not by 2030? And if you explain them about the mitigation costs and then the price says, oh, that might be too costly. And this is something which should be clear. Bans, standards, and subsidies are not costless options. It's about the salience. And what I'm saying is, in the past, carbon pricing was too salient, and the other one. So it was a little bit hidden. In the future, I would say the salience argument will not work, because we will see also increasing costs, and people will see and observe this increasing costs of the other instruments. So this is what I can offer here in this debate. And if people say, okay, then we have two ambitious climate targets, so then we are in a different debate. Then we are talking about the goals and not about the means.
Okay, David.
Yeah, I want to pick up on this, because I think this is a very important place of both agreement and disagreement. So first, I'm shocked to discover that politicians are inconsistent, because we never see that in any other area
of
political
no.
behavior. It's just amazing. But I think this really goes to the salience point. I really appreciate Ottmar bringing out the salience point, because a big part of our argument is that, in particular in some sectors, and as Danny underscored, in the transportation sector in particular, the salience generates these extra political difficulties. So I think it is very, very helpful to, let me just say two things about this. One is, our argument is not that there's no role for carbon pricing. Our argument is that, in particular, there's a role for carbon tax-like mechanisms instead of cap and trade mechanisms, for reasons I mentioned, and that they are going to complement what really pushes the technological frontier, especially in these hard to abate sectors. And so it's exactly as Ottmar showed, and as Danny suggested, that in the sectors where the technologies are more mature, notably electric power, and maybe we're going to get to that point in gas eventually, not initially, that carbon pricing could play a bigger role. So it's going to be some kind of hybrid where there's probably going to be a bigger role. And this, to me, frankly, in this book project was a surprise to me, the extent to which I came around to the idea of a much, frankly, much bigger role for the state. That was not my more normal, not my temperament. So I think that's crucially important. And then the last thing I want to say is about the future. So obviously we can't measure the future, but if a theory like the one we lay out, that Danny and I lay out in our book, is helpful, it's going to be helpful in describing what might happen in the future. And I think we would see a bigger role for carbon pricing in the future, but for the different causal logic than the one that I think Ottmar has laid out here, which is, in the future, there's going to be an even bigger role for direct industrial policies, regulatory policies, bans, and so on, to reshape markets. And then as those markets have more mature technologies that are available to them, then more sectors are going to start behaving like the electric power sector, where there's a role for carbon pricing. I don't know if it's going to be up in the 300 euro range, but it is just sobering to remind us that, look, for example, what Equinor is doing in the North Sea with this big Northern Lights carbon capture and storage project. This is a company that faces the highest carbon price in the world for its offshore operations and could not justify doing these big transformative carbon capture and storage projects without direct industrial policy, without direct support. And so I think that's an example where the carbon pricing is playing a role, absolutely. And then, but what makes the project feasible as well is this direct industrial policy. And that's a kind of key argument in the book, is that more of that is doing the work. And that's why, when you see only 23% of global emissions covered in carbon pricing, the picture is even grimmer than that, Petra, because the average price outside of Europe, the average price for that 23% is tiny. It's a couple dollars.
Let me try to sharpen the difference between you a little bit further, because I think there's a certain agreement that we might need a couple of political instruments to get things done. But I, as a journalist, I see that the focus of politicians is quite often very limited on one or two things that they are able to get done. So my question is actually, if you had to advise government, your advice would rather be, get away with the CO2 pricing. Don't put your political future on that part. Look for other things. Look for subsidies, for sectorial policies, because this will be more efficient. Whereas Ottmar says, no, it's still the CO2 pricing, where you should put most of your effort into. Is this correct?
Let me comment briefly on this, and then I want to ask Danny to comment on this, because Danny's directly advising governments, in particular in the United States. And again, I think the European situation, because of the quality of the European administrative legal arrangement because of the EU backstop for improving commitment, improving credibility. The European situation is really very different, but that's it, Petra, exactly what I would argue is that it's not so much, you know, ignore carbon pricing altogether, but if you really want to transform these sectors and make big reductions in emissions, you have to have a much bigger role for smart industrial policy. The next book that I'm working on, what's coming out in August with Chuck Sable, is on exactly that, how industrial policy and how companies deal with uncertainty, where they have to invest in new technologies, they don't know what to do, and so they run experiments. And that part of the picture, which Danny and I begin to sketch out in our book, that part of the picture is what I'm taking up next. But I think that's exactly would be our advice. Danny?
I'll just add, again, this isn't an argument where one has the capacity to push forward on carbon pricing not to do that. We think where you can, that's a good thing to do. But just briefly to comment on the institutional capacities, Ottmar makes a very good point. When you combine carbon pricing or frankly regulatory standards with rebates, you can make policies that have costs and have regressive costs progressive so that lower income households come out ahead. One of the huge challenges is how do you actually get money into people's hands? So for years, I've been working on this issue in the US and in California, and we frankly don't have instrumental capacities to take money. Supposing you had the money, you had the policy, and get them out to all of the people who are affected. I hope that your capacity to do that in Germany and Europe is significantly better than ours. But when you look under the hood at what's required to accomplish some of these policy strategies and carbon pricing, it takes sometimes building entire new state capacity to do things like reach all of the people who pay taxes, reach all of the people who are affected by higher energy prices. And if you have to stand that capacity up as a prerequisite to addressing one of the major political challenges of the carbon pricing strategy, you can see how that's a tough sell in an environment where somebody hasn't already put in the work to get that done. So, and the reason I bring this up is because many countries and jurisdictions are in that situation. Not all are as capable as moving on these issues as many countries in Europe and Scandinavia are.
I don't want to be awkward, but if you were based in Europe, maybe your position would be rather closer to Ottmar's. And if Ottmar were in the United States, he would be closer to yours. Is it in the end geography that determines your position?
It's administrative capacity. This commitment issue is really, really important because almost everything that's interesting in deep decarbonization is capital intensive, requires long time horizons, and really, really sensitive to the capacity of government in what using whatever combination of policy mechanisms it's using, government to send a reliable signal, whether it's to state-owned enterprises or private enterprise, you know, at every country varies and so on. And so I think we often, in comparative politics world, often equates that with region, but that's my view is that's been sloppy social science, that what's really matters here is the quality and credibility of the underlying administrative institutions and political institutions. One of the opportunities that Danny and I saw when we were writing this book is there's now been such a huge variation in the experiences with cap and trade and carbon tax mechanisms across a varied different sets of sectors and national and subnational systems of policy administration, that there's a lot of variance out there now that can be used by social scientists to try and build and test theories of the type that we're doing in this book.
Could you just very briefly, because I think not all of our of the people listening to us are economists, the difference between cap and trade and CO2 pricing, can you put it into three sentences?
Sure. So a cap and trade system basically puts a limit on the total allowable emissions, at least for the covered sectors, and then leaves the market to figure out the price level. So the idea is that then the market will, then the permits trade on the open market, and then the trading price tells you, reveals in effect the information about the cost at the margin of controlling those emissions. In a carbon tax system, you do the opposite. You put a limit on the price. You say, this is the price, and then the market figures out the quantity that's needed there. If everyone had perfect information, the two would be in effect identical. Everyone doesn't have perfect information. And one of the reasons that Danny and I are big fans of carbon taxes as a complementary pricing mechanism, as opposed to cap and trade systems, is that we think the carbon tax in effect is like a metaphor for the allowable, politically viable level of effort. And so when you can set that level of effort and then firms see that that cost in all of their investment decisions, then that's politically more credible and stable than one where the prices kind of bounce all over the place. And so to Ottmar's point, I really appreciated his slide saying the four areas of disagreement to the we completely agree in the area with regard to volatility in these prices is that the way you lower the volatility in a cap and trade system is you in effect do, as Danny described it, central banker functions. You add and subtract volumes of credit so that you in effect transform a cap and trade system into something that's de facto more like a carbon tax system.
Peter, yeah, I would like
to respond because that's quite important because this shows the area of agreement and disagreement. First of all, I would say the whole issue of carbon pricing is in the end an investment in state capacity. So this is the essential point. Now I would like to highlight at least three dimensions of the state capacity. The first one is, I think in Europe, we cannot have a carbon tax. This has constitutional reasons. We have to live with the cap and trade. And therefore, I am a strong proponent of a carbon price floor in order to reduce the volatility and to get rid of all the things Danny and David have described. I think this is an area of strong agreement, and I fully agree when on your evaluation of the advantages and disadvantages of carbon pricing. And I'm also 100% on your side when you talk about this offset issue, the voluntary carbon markets. And even what you said, David, on the international carbon markets. And let me highlight this as a second dimension. So it is often said by many people in the public that economists advocate one unique carbon price across all the sectors, across all the countries. But in fact, this is not true. This is not true. So I'm doing now a paper with my colleague of Marc Fleber, where we show that even from a purely efficiency point of view, one unique carbon price is not efficient. If you have one unique carbon price, this would require massive transfers either across regions or either across the sectors. Otherwise, you cannot do this. And therefore, I think...
Could you please short and briefly explain why this would be killing the whole thing?
Because think about the best way to think about this is think about India and Europe or India and the United States. So we have one goal, let's say a focal point, the 2 degree or the 1.5 degree limit in the end, right? It doesn't matter. So in the end, the whole world has to reduce emissions. So if there would be one unit carbon price of $100 per ton CO2, so the impact, the distributional impact on India would be much higher than compared to US and India. And why should India or another like Vietnam or Indonesia pay such a high price? You can only do this if they're basically, we would say, okay, we transfer to a certain extent money in order to make the whole thing affordable, in order to harmonize the willingness to pay of all the countries. So this is very important to understand. And this is, by the way, the reason why I fully agree that a global cap and trade system will never work, because you have one unit carbon price, but then you have to take care of the distributional issue. So then you have to reallocate all the initial endowments, which is basically a nightmarish thing. And all international cooperation will break down if you would do this. This is the reason why I believe we should have not negotiations about a global cap and trade system, but because about minimum prices among a coalition of the willing. This would be, from my point of view, much more doable. It's hard enough, but this is this myth that the unit carbon price is efficient. And the last thing, a practical thing, because Danny said, do you have the state capacity to recycle the money? Interesting enough, last 2 weeks ago, Austria decided exactly to do this. They have invested in the state capacity. By next year, they will recycle the money back to the citizens, and to make very clear that the money they generate via carbon prices or this kind of Pigouvian taxes will be recycled back to the citizens. I think this is a quite credible a credible promise, and I think all of you agree that in the end, the commitment problem is at the core of the whole thing. And I believe that the central banking function Danny has highlighted is something which the EU Commission is in the end doing. The EU Commission is functioning already like a kind of a central carbon bank. And to be honest, if we, I'm done in a second. If we would do this a little bit more explicit, we could strengthen the commitment problem, or we could strengthen the commitment capacity to a larger extent. But I think this is a very well taken point. The EU Commission is basically functioning as a kind of a European carbon bank, de facto, not the euro.
But let's stick for a second still with the with this idea of a global CO2 price in the global market. One of the questions that that I see in the chat is that you very well explained us why it's not an easy go to have the why it will not be possible to have the same CO2 price between India and Germany, for example, or between India and the EU. One of the arguments that that I heard from you and the others too as well is that it's rather difficult to also have one CO2 price between for all the sectors. And the question that Lars Heidemann is raising, why do you, I think three of you agree that it's rather toxic to add the transports, especially the transport sector, to have the same CO2 price for the transport sector and the other sectors as well. Who could answer that question?
I'd be happy to start and welcome other perspectives. So I think one of the core insights from our book is that the politics vary by sector. They vary according to the salience of the sector, which can vary by place and time as well. And they vary according to the technological options for reducing emissions. And something I think I heard all of us agreeing on is the electricity sector is a fairly good sector from the standpoint of the political challenge. That's because we have lots of technologies that are ready to go, largely as a result of industrial policy and other forms of government intervention. Renewable energy is now cheap. We have other frontier technologies that can be deployed. And the electricity industry is a well-regulated industry in most countries, which means policymakers have tools for addressing regressive impacts. They don't have to stand up new administrative capacity to do that. So the combination of those forces makes that sector and the technological opportunities in it relatively easy to address with carbon pricing. Conversely, when you look at transportation, that may be the most politically salient and challenging with relatively few options that are price sensitive. And so that makes it hard. The argument we make in the book is the industrial sector is very heterogeneous. There are very different experiments going on in cement and steel and other carbon intensive, capital intensive industries. Whereas, as David highlighted, even in places that have the highest carbon prices, the firms that are trying to experiment on deployment of those technologies require more support and engagement from the state to make that happen. So one of the central arguments from our book is when you combine the sectors and put them under a single carbon pricing policy, you risk that the carbon pricing policy can only be as ambitious as the least constraining sector is politically. So standard economic advice, and I'm delighted to hear Ottmar is open-minded about this. Standard economic advice says put all of the sectors, put all of the countries together, go for one price. We're arguing more in the opposite direction, which is to say, if you want carbon pricing, it applies best sector specific and jurisdiction specific. So many carbon prices is a much more realistic way to think about using carbon pricing to complement all the other strategies that are out there. I heard some agreement, maybe some disagreement on that, but we really think the sectors are different.
Yeah, so
that's a very good point. And here we can identify very nicely the agreement and the disagreement. So first of all, I agree, I fully agree, it would be completely impossible now, today, to integrate the transport sector in the ETS one, where basically it's the ETS for electricity, for the power market, and for the industry. And therefore, the EU decided, and I was involved in the design of this, a second ETS, where basically the transport and the building sector is included. So, and this requires a much higher carbon price. Of course, it requires a higher carbon price. And there is an inefficient, let's say, division from a static efficiency point of view. It is an inefficient division of labor between the two sectors. But if you want to do a carbon price, you say it very lightly, so that the most politically constrained sector determines the level of the carbon price. Again, in an ideal world, you could transfer money from one sector to another to get rid of this, but this is practically across the sectors not feasible. However, so this is the point of agreement. Now it comes to the disagreement. When we want to do deep carbonization, we cannot think that the transport sector, the power sector, and the industry sector are completely different things. So we have to think about direct and indirect electrification. Sector coupling becomes important. As soon as you start with sector coupling, in the end, what you are doing is you are doing an industrial carbon management. And this, for this purpose, you need in the long run a carbon price. And therefore, my proposal always was, we start with two different prices, but over time, we try to make sure that we can basically combine both systems. So in the end, not the starting point, but as a focal point in the future, we have a unique carbon price, at least not all sectors, because the agriculture sector is a different thing. And it is probably not wise to include the agriculture sector in the system. But then you have at least among the sectors which are important for direct and indirect electrification. But this is something which requires a decade and has to be complemented by all sorts of support for pilot projects and so on. So but for me, this industrial carbon cycle management is in the future such a complex thing that it is for me not conceivable that you can run and design and steer such a system purely with bans and subsidies and standards.
Yeah, and it's very, very quick. I think that's very well articulated. You want to get as quickly as possible to a system where where firms are selecting more mature technologies and where the market's playing a bigger role. I think at this stage right now, it's unknowable how quickly that's going to happen. Maybe it's a decade, maybe it's longer. Sometimes we discover things happen faster, sometimes they don't. I just also want to underscore that when you're engaged in a complete industrial transformation, so I want to underscore a point that Ottmar made, the boundaries around the sectors get kind of fuzzy because you know what's important is the role for steel changes if you have a bigger role for bamboo instead of steel. The role for transportation really changes when you electrify transportation because then suddenly the transport sector is also the electric sector. And so what in effect is happening is we're running these pilots, having these bans, complementing them to some degree with a measure of carbon pricing. And then as those technologies then mature and the boundaries around these different sectors are in effect rewritten, then to the extent feasible, you use markets to be able to optimize those choices. That for most sectors right now is still significantly in the future.
What about the speed question? I mean, we all know that time is not running out, but that the time when we overstep 1.5 degrees is getting closer. So what about the speediest, best possibilities that we have?
Maybe I can just talk briefly about this because I've never thought 1.5 was feasible. I've actually never thought 2 was feasible. That's a larger debate. Probably that's not the subject of today. But I think the reason that today's debate is important is because this debate and similar debates that are happening right now about policy instruments and how do you put together and hold together political support for action, which is greater in Europe than anywhere else on the planet. Europe has been the reliable leader on climate. Parts of the U.S. are reliable leaders, but not all the U.S. And go around the world, you see highly variable pictures. I think that's the real debate. And what we need to do is have programs that are as cost-effective as possible, are highly effective in terms of making big reductions in emissions, and we move those as quickly as we can. When I take a step back from that process as someone who studied the history of technological change, I don't see that happening at the speed you need for 1.5 degrees, certainly, but probably for 2 degrees. And so therefore, there's kind of a whole bias built into the whole debate that's underplayed the role of dealing with climate impacts and overplayed the role of mitigation. Not the mitigation is not important, quite the opposite, but just that if you really work the problem hard, which is I think what we're now talking about doing here, you still don't push the system as quickly as you need for 2 degrees.
And in addition, probably the political, the global environment is not one where collaboration is as it's best at the moment. I know that the German government is, we are heading for the G7 in Germany. The German government is trying to get some content into its climate club, where you have issues like border adjustment, taxes, and all this. And I don't think that they're really, really going as quickly as they should.
I think it is important when we have such a debate. When you say, what about the speed? Or what about the distribution of things? Then we have to make sure that we compare the right things, right? And we should not compare the first best carbon price with second best standards. So this doesn't make sense. So make sure that we compare the right things. And if you compare the right things, it is obvious that technology standards were very successful to increase the efficiency, for example, of cars. But standards were not successful to reduce emissions. So this is something which is important. And when you ask the speed issue, the myth, so to say, that subsidies and bans and standards are much more quickly than prices is the wrong question. From my point of view, the right question is, what is the appropriate sequencing of policy instruments? And this is, therefore, I think it is not helpful if we continue the same debate for the next decade, where some economists say, oh, I have a first best policy, and then a political science says, oh, this is from a political point of view not feasible. So we should basically say, okay, we have a policy, and let's try to test this policy under specific political circumstances, and let's figure out what is the possibility. And if it turns out that we cannot be fast enough, so then from my point of view, and this is missing in the whole debate, is, so what can we do to invest in state capacity? So carbon pricing is not saying you don't need the state. You need for a carbon price even more state capacity, and you have to invest in the state capacity. And this is something which we should have in mind when it is not. So I studied a little bit the example of Austria with this recycling scheme. This is not an easy go, but they invested in the state capacity instead of saying it's impossible. And I think this is equally important when we talk about speed and what kind of policy instruments can be implemented. So we should then be explicit. Is it under the given state capacity? And what can we do to enhance the state capacity?
Anyone of you want to comment?
I agree with that completely. And state capacity is not a static concept. And for too long, people have treated it as a static concept. There's a logical extension to this argument, which is maybe beyond the scope of today's debate, which is that what we're going to see now around the world is huge variation in state capacity. We already have that. And plausibly that inequality, if you like, is going to go up. And that has big, big implications for the decarbonization debate, because if it's capital intensive, it requires long time horizons, credible policies, and highly capable states. And some states are investing, other states are not investing. My hunch is that a very large part of the story in the coming decades around decarbonization is going to be the growing inequality in state capacity and the capacity actually to invest in these emission reductions. Now that intersects obviously with the debate that we're talking about today, because whether you think carbon pricing is going to have a bigger role or a smaller role, you think industrial policy is going to have a bigger role or a smaller role, all of these are mechanisms that require much more capable state. Capabilities vary, but the capabilities of state are just vitally important.
Danny, how optimistic are you? Pessimistic?
I think David's got it right. I think capacity is the big issue. And I think a lot, you know, frankly, working in jurisdictions where capacity is a big constraint. And one of the things I reflect on is carbon pricing doesn't work very well in those conditions. Lots of things don't work very well in those conditions. But in a lot of respects, jurisdictions that are struggling with capacity take the situation as they find it. So the decision by the German auto manufacturers to shift away from internal combustion engines, the decision by the Chinese engine manufacturers to move into zero emission vehicles, that means that jurisdictions that don't have as active a presence, whether on standards or carbon pricing, are going to see the sort of ramifications of those technological changes. So I see that the technology shifting activities being particularly important for jurisdictions that don't have a lot of technical capacity in their administrative state. And to be perfectly honest, when I look at those transformations, I don't see carbon pricing driving those transformations, although I agree with Ottmar that the more we push on that and the deeper we go, the more we need to center on efficiency given the scale of the problem. But in terms of the sequencing, the things that move the frontier are rarely carbon pricing. And I was interested to hear, I think I heard Ottmar say that the sequencing carbon pricing is more important later than it is earlier. That is not the standard prescription that economists gave 10 years ago, and maybe wiser economists like Ottmar had always been in a different place. But to me, that feels like a very different sequencing than the sort of standard textbook arguments we hear, where when you don't have capacity, a carbon price makes it easy to throw your hands up and say the market will take care of all of this. Mm-hmm. When in practice, I think jurisdictions that don't have that capacity basically are free riding on the capacity of others to transform individual sectors.
It's very interesting. One of the lessons that I'm already drawing is that this idea that one size fits all and carbon pricing could be this one size fits all thing is just not true, because every country is different, every region is different. And maybe in Europe, we can really go ahead with the carbon pricing because we have lots of experience. Whereas in some of the US states or even in other countries, it's just not the way to go because we don't have the institutions.
Yeah, but I think it is important to understand that indeed, and this is something which I will emphasize, state capacity is not a static concept. And here I would like to highlight another thing. So we are talking about positive carbon prices, but there are also negative carbon prices, which are subsidies on fossil fuels. And now there's a very interesting debate in countries like I'm a little bit involved in Indonesia to get rid of fossil fuel subsidies. And this was partly driven by the debate on CBAM in Europe. And we should not ignore this aspect that—
Explain CBAM just for a second, because I don't think that everybody knows it.
Okay, so we had roughly speaking in Europe a debate that we basically want to impose a tariff on carbon intensive goods. It's technically speaking much more complicated, but this is the story. So and this was a threat, so to say. Europe said we contemplate this and we might do this. And then basically Europe is sets to a certain extent standards here, and in some countries people become quite concerned about this threat and start to think about what can we do on carbon pricing, or can we at least reduce the fossil fuel subsidies. And if you, and I fully agree, there is a lot of variation around the globe. And if you see how different countries, even unusual suspects, the unusual suspects have phased out fossil fuel subsidies, then this shows that even in countries which you might not conceive as the forerunner in this respect, can very cleverly change this state capacity issue. And therefore, for me, this is really the crucial thing. And in the debate, we have always the same things, and I become really tired about this debate, where people always say, this is not possible. Of course, some things are not possible today, but they might be possible tomorrow. And if it's not possible tomorrow and we invest in the right thing, it might become possible then in a later stage. And it seems to me that analyzing the state capacities in climate policy is something which is incredibly important. And also the design of, so the combination of forensic climate economics and clinical climate economics is exactly the way to go over this, because we want to understand state capacity. It has something to do with corruption, but we want to understand under what specific conditions you can change state capacity to make important things happen.
Okay, let me you wait briefly?
Yeah, just briefly, I want to say two things. First, on the state capacity issue, I had the pleasure a few years ago of working with the World Bank doing a big study on the political economy of subsidy reform. And this is exactly what we found, is that it was the unlikely countries that did a lot of subsidy reform on fossil fuels. And it was the key enabling condition was not treating state capacity as static. It was investing in smart cards and other mechanisms for being able to channel resources back. The other thing I wanted to say is about this CBAM, the border adjustment mechanism. I think one of the areas where there's a significant disagreement still is about the relative roles of regulatory industrial policy instruments and market instruments. The more that people believe that the arguments that Danny and I are making are plausible about this big role for regulatory instruments and so on, the more we have to think about CBAM adjustments, the border adjustments, as not just being differentials in price, but also being the regulatory equivalents. And the World Trade Organization has been through this in a lot of other areas and non-tariff trade barriers. And I think that the implications of that we haven't really grappled with. And we've assumed that we could just identify by looking at relative price levels what the right border adjustment should be. We don't think that's true.
Okay, the cut that I want to make is because we have a couple of questions regarding the distributional effects of CO2 pricing. Simon Jüngling, for example, asks, what are the main challenges of implementing a recycling scheme? Regressive effects are avoidable, yet opponents of carbon pricing appear to have success in convincing the public that carbon pricing is somehow unfair. Why?
Yeah, that's quite easy,
because the poor households spend a much higher share of the income for transport and for heating. So a carbon price is regressive. And so we can discuss the precise schemes of revenue recycling. So this makes the carbon price progressive. And again, the missing part, one important missing component in the whole debate over the last 10 years was that basically economists have used an efficiency argument, and they assume that the distributional issues will be resolved in an almost costly way. By the way, this was also the problem with free trade. We said that the winners could compensate the losers, but the losers are not interested in hypothetical compensation. They are interested in real compensation. And if we say carbon pricing is a wonderful thing because the winners could compensate the losers and they have a welfare gain. So this is a hypothetical welfare test, but in the end, the losers are interested in real compensation. So in that sense, and I worked over the last 2 years very, very hardly on this issue to work out. And by the way, you might say, okay, this CO2 pricing recycling, this is a purely academic exercise. So to make some things a little bit more feasible. But what we will experience over the next few months, in particular in Europe, is a sharp increase of the gas prices. Mm-hmm. And this is something which is really threatening the social cohesion in Germany, in Europe, in the European Union. And this has nothing to do with climate policy. This is a pure fact because of the war in the Ukraine. And we come up with an analysis, are the current compensation packages the government has basically designed sufficient for this? And we come to the conclusion it's not. And therefore, some kind of per capita recycling, some kind of helicopter money will be absolutely essential. Because when we do not care of this issue, so if this is burned in the historical memory of people that fossil fuel price increase comes with a decline of social cohesion, with a decline of social justice, so then the whole legitimacy of climate policy will also erode significantly. And I think even if you don't believe climate policy is an important issue, we have to deal with the Ukraine. This distributional issue will become, over the next few months, a big, big issue.
David, isn't there the same kind of problem when you give large subsidies to companies because you're convinced that an industrial policy is the good policy to do, but this is also money that needs to be raised by taxes.
Yeah. So there's a one of the things we haven't talked about today with regard to the book is there's a whole chapter in the book. I think it's chapter 6. It's about what do you do with the money, mm-hmm. and just to emphasize something that Ottmar's saying. That's that part of the whole debate about the design of market instruments has been really underplayed. Partly because so many of the market instruments are cap and trade systems and they don't spin up as large resources as carbon tax systems. And then most of the carbon tax systems, the money flows back through the state and is used for a variety of other purposes. If you can create a revenue recycling program that's seen as credible, then that actually helps solve some of the commitment problem that Ottmar was talking about here, because you then create an interest group. But I think that also is the fine line here. Industrial policy is the same challenge, Petra, as you just suggested, that you create a subsidy for an industrial group that wants to go invest in some new technology, and then it's hard to remove the subsidy. And so the idea that industrial policy and regulations and bans and so on are a key element of a serious response in deep decarbonization is not a license then to do them in a reckless way and not set them up so that they don't have sunset clauses and a variety of other things, so that you can continue to keep the resources of the state, places where firms are allowed to collaborate and so on, continue to keep those resources targeted on the places that are really advancing the technological frontier.
Danny, you want to add something?
Just that, again, I think this capacity question is at the center of it. To give you an example of what's going on in California, we have very high gasoline prices. It's a very politically sensitive issue, and different parts of the government are trying to figure out how to refund money back to people. There's competing positions. The elements of the legislature have said, let's send refunds to people who file taxes. And the governor's office has said, let's send refunds to people who have car registrations. Why are we talking at such strange ways of rebating money? We don't actually have a simple pre-existing mechanism to send money back to people. So if you send it back to people who file taxes, you may not be getting all of the people who aren't citizens, who are paying for higher costs, but haven't filed because of our extraordinarily complex tax system with the state tax regulator. You're going to pick up more of those underprivileged and lower income households if you do it through car registration, but now you're subsidizing car ownership. And all of these complex debates are playing out right now, and there's no simple resolution precisely because we don't even here in California have a way of reaching all of the people who live here with a financial.
I thought your presidents were pretty used to sending us checks to people.
Even the transfers that you've seen in during the COVID era, for example, took forever to get to many households. The capacity to reach people is a key barrier to this issue. So just I'm flagging that because that's true in many, many places, including in very wealthy and relatively well-resourced governments.
It's an interesting part of the debate that apparently institutions are not yet used to handing out money to people. In Germany, we have the debate just the other way around, where we debate whether they're handing out too much money and not well targeted.
But Austria has resolved the problem.
I would like to add that that's remarkable, right? So it's okay. But one issue I would like to highlight here, and this is something because we discussed the whole issue a little bit, so to say, about jurisdictions. But we are not living in a world where basically we can only analyze the EU or even Germany. And I would like to highlight this on one important issue. So what we have seen over the last 3 months is a sharp increase of the gas price, and the gas price has a much higher growth rate than the coal price. And this brought coal back around the globe in Asia, but also in Europe. And without so we are lucky to a certain extent in Europe that we have the emissions trading scheme, because when the gas price is increasing and coal becomes competitive in the system, so then the CO2 price is also increasing and pushes coal out of the system, at least in a way which basically is consistent with the cap. Therefore, it's such a threat when the EU Commission now thinks to sell permits, because this sends the completely wrong signal to the market. But one thing here I would like to highlight, and this is my example, is why it is so important to have a system which can deal with the international price fluctuations on the resource markets. And what we see now is that with gas price and the coal price, this is an incredibly important thing. And such relative price changes, such abrupt and almost instantaneous price changes, this is something which any kind of climate and energy policy has to deal with. And therefore, I think designing mechanisms which basically are quite robust, it's very wise. And I think in the current situation, the ETS1 at least helps us to stick to the European Emissions Trading Scheme.
Okay, maybe I can ask you one question that Mario Hüttenhofer himself calls a demonic question. Shouldn't we focus much more on taxing all gas, coal companies at the well and making pressure to fossil energy producers and states instead of starting the whole thing from the demand side? What do you think?
In an ideal world,
an upstream system is much better than a downstream system. I would agree, but this is something which is which basically the ETS2 in Europe is an upstream system, almost an upstream system, and I think we should push for an upstream system. Yes.
Yeah, I mean this is partly an old administrative question. A pure upstream system where we would be actually taxing it in Saudi Arabia and so on is something that has been fun to talk about and is irrelevant to the real world. And so de facto what's happening is we have a bunch of systems that are downstream in the sense that they are being applied in the jurisdictions that have the greatest willingness to do something about emissions right now, and that tend to be importers, not only importers, look at my country. And then they're de facto implemented in a way that makes them as upstream as possible just for reasons of administrative efficiency.
But the interesting thing is because you made a very funny remark. So taxing Saudi Arabia, I'm not saying we should tax Saudi Arabia, but I think what we should do in Europe is we should tax imports from gas and oil. And we should tax in particular Russian gas and oil, because this is taxing rents away. And this is extremely important. Taxing rents away is something where we can do something good to limit the revenues for Putin, but at the same time to signal the market that basically we want to become independent. And the second ETS system, the second emission trading scheme in Europe, would basically form a kind of a demand cartel of Europe on that market. And therefore, it is a tragedy. For me, it is a tragedy that the European Parliament has basically rejected the system. So probably they promise in 2 weeks we will come up with a different proposal. But this is something which is enormously important to understand. An emission trading scheme, at least in Europe, or even a tax system, has also some sort of geopolitical implications where we would reduce resource rents from autocratic regimes. And this is something which we should also contemplate a little bit more. And this has a benefit for the consumers in Europe because we become more independent. And this also generates revenues from rents, which from an efficiency point of view are it's a quite favorable thing to do.
Yeah, and let me just say, I'm mindful of the time. I think a demand cartel is overdue, and in particular on the gas side. There's no way to really deal with the dependence on the Russian supply without forming, in effect, a gas buyers union or a cartel or something like that. I will say there's an area of disagreement, probably disagreement here, around this issue of selling the emission credits to lower prices and so on. I think from Danny and I see this as part of the central banker functions, that it's not ideal, but I think the larger political point you made, Ottmar, that if there's a huge political blowback because of high natural gas and other energy prices, and people associate that, rightly or wrongly, with climate and other kinds of policies, then that will set back the whole effort for a generation. And so I don't frankly begrudge governments that are trying to manage that within the zone of what they think is politically feasible, knowing that the political feasibility is going to be dynamic. But we really have to be careful that we don't overreach here, especially as this really could erode social fabric.
So we are short on time. I think time is running out. Just one very brief question at the end. If I listen to your debate, I feel it's highly educated. Do you feel that it resonates today more in political circles or less? Do you feel better understood than 10 years ago? Or do you have the feeling that it's just politicians are moving away from these kind of questions and debates?
I think they're in the middle of these questions and debates because they're doing stuff.
Okay.
And you have more familiarity with that in Europe because you're doing more stuff. But we're now starting. And so, I mean, do I feel perfectly understood by politicians? No. But do I feel like they're pursuing these questions with greater vigor than they were 5 years ago or 10 years ago? Absolutely.
Danny?
I think that's right. And I think in the United States, we have a particularly strange situation, which is that our state level action or subnational action is working off of a 20-year-old political playbook, because the institutions that got put in place are very similar to the policy strategies Europe put in place, but without a lot of the administrative capacity. So we are playing catch up to these conversations, and I hear this debate and the contours of it echoed very loudly in the places where I work. So I would agree with David's sentiment as well.
I would say politicians are much more open to such a debate, but economists have to change, and they change because so carbon pricing is not an issue for a kind of theology, right? So it's not about dogmatics. It's about, in the end, it's about empirics. And what we are doing now is we carrying out a large scale ex post analysis under what conditions carbon pricing have worked and what we can learn from the design for the carbon pricing. So and what are the preconditions, what are the limits
of the recommendations. I think that's a very good conversation. And so still a lot of disagreement remains with Danny and David, but still, I think we're on the same side when we say we want to have good policy and good politics. So this is something which we would like. And the worst thing is if you have a good policy and you have bad politics, or you have bad politics and bad policy. So I think that's something which is worthwhile to do. And this is a much more enlightened debate than we had probably 10 years ago.
Okay, thanks to you. I think the forensic part of the issue, we will kind of have hopefully another debate, but now I just hand over to Jörg, who is going to say some final words. The floor is yours, Jörg.
Yeah, first of all, I really would like to thank all panelists for this absolutely fascinating debate. I really learned a lot, and I will definitely hear it again on the recording. The recording will be on YouTube. It will be available both in English and in German. So for all the audiences who also, like me, want to hear the whole thing once more, just to capture all the nuances, just go to the Böll channel on YouTube. I'm absolutely really fascinated and in agreement with Ottmar's statement that this is about empirics and not theology. I think it's absolutely vital that we get this right. It's about 1.5 to 2 or whatever. We need to get this right. It's absolutely vital. These instrumental debate about the instruments, and I think that was the start of a conversation. I actually am also already ordered the next book of David together with Charles Sable about fixing the climate. I think I will put it in the chat somewhere. It's not yet out there, but it will be out there. And I'm looking forward to reading it over the summer. I'm curious to hear more because, maybe we are more advanced in Europe in terms of actually implementing climate policy. We still can learn a lot also from other people, smart people who are thinking about this stuff. And so I'm obviously always curious about learning new things. And maybe, David, we can have another similar seminar with Charles Sable, and maybe again Ottmar, just to go to continue the conversation, because it's a really fascinating debate. Petra, also thanks to you for an absolutely smart way of moderating the debate. And I hope everybody has enjoyed it as much as I did. So thanks all.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. So all the best.
All the best to all of you.
Yeah. Take care. Bye-bye.
Good afternoon.
Have a nice day, David. Bye-bye.
Okay. Good to see you.
Thanks.